August 1936. The Olympic Games in Berlin were a great success for Hitler and his people. Yet the Nazis were far too mediocre, except when it came to crime, to invent anything new, including in the realm of great performances and sport. Even before the Nazis rose to power, the Weimar Republic had already grasped the interest of using great physical, athletic, and mechanical feats to help get Germany back on its feet. Of the Third Reich were entirely focused on orchestrating and pushing one-upmanship to the limit, on land or in the air. But in so doing, they steered all their models straight into disaster. The impressive boxer, Max Schmeling, solid as a rock, indefatigable worker and budding world champion. Archangel Bernd Rosemeyer, brave and daring, able to master the wildest racing cars of the day. Intrepid aviator Ernst Udet, brilliant inventor, author of countless aeronautic exploits. The gigantic Hindenburg, swollen with hydrogen and pride, holder of 1,000 records for speed and distance. The most hardened and well-equipped mountain climbers, off in the Himalayas to conquer the world's highest peaks. Not to mention Olympic athletes such as Lutz Long, the elegant young long jumper who simply wasn't permitted to fall short. Even the alluring Leni Riefenstahl, zealous and determined champion of athletic expression. Hitler's ambassadors were meant to be infallible heroes, while in fact, they were simply the signs of looming failure. Reichssportsführer von Chammer was more interested in Greece. There, ever in search of a glorious lineage, he anchored the games more firmly in antiquity and came up with a few innovations of his own, behind the backs of Olympic authorities. In Olympia, a first for the modern games, 12 mini-skirted pseudo-virgins captured the fire of the gods in a sort of metallic barbecue fashioned by the Krupp Company. Fire was then used to light a torch, intended to show the entire world that all roads lead to Berlin. Another innovation, the 3,341 relay runners called upon to link Olympia to Germany, antiquity to modernity. Bulgaria, Romania, Austria, countries the Reich already had its envious eye on, where its cameras were already filming. Last stop before Germany, Czechoslovakia, where the arrival of the flame was carefully staged. Meanwhile, in Berlin, everyone was getting ready. Hitler and Goebbels didn't give it a second thought. Who but Leni Riefenstahl could depict the games in a manner worthy of their lofty designs? She was granted 45 camera operators in all, often perched high on cranes. or tucked away in pits to capture the beauty of movement and the aesthetics of bodies. Cameras everywhere, even underwater if need be. Science, technology, and modernity were also the order of the day, and Germany became an incomparable test bench. No field was ignored in that summer of 36. For the festivities, prelude to the games, ace pilot Ernst Udet also got roped in.
Ernst Udet startete eben noch einmal zu einem atemberaubenden Sturzflug, den uns aus wenigstens 4500 Metern Höhe vorführen wird.
Maybe it was still just a game, but already the confusion between spectacle and reality was at work. An impressive nosedive for sure. What the announcer didn't mention was how it also served to test and develop the future Stuka dive bomber that would spread terror once the war broke out. Göring, Udet's friend and superior, was well aware of this. While the whole world was thinking of Germany in terms of the games, the country doubled its military spending in 1 year, thumbing its nose at the Treaty of Versailles. Once more, it was Leni Riefenstahl's job to show this, if not the world, then at least to Germany. Ah, what a lovely diversion the games were, with everyone so eager to plunge into them. Not least of all, France, where a Pathé newsreel ventured a rather audacious parallel.
2 août 1914, mobilisation pour la guerre. 1er août 1936, mobilisation pour le sport et la paix. Et si de jeunes Français partent pour Berlin, ce n'est que pour de loyaux combats sur le seul terrain sportif.
But not everyone was fooled. Demonstrations were held in the US and various cities throughout Europe. A scant showing to counter the great event in preparation. To the very end, the communists, mainly, tried hard to believe in the possibility of a counter games in Barcelona, but that hope quickly fizzled when the Spanish Civil War broke out. Besides, how could anyone fight Nazi duplicity when even influential foreign leaders were turning a blind eye to it? Just look at Mr. Avery Brundage, president of the American Athletic Union, peeking out from behind his ad hoc brochure.
The Olympic Games belong to the athletes and not to the politicians. Knowing the temper of the true sport leaders, they will never allow our athletes to be made martyrs to a cause not their own, or amateur sport to be sacrificed to a political issue. 49 nations have accepted the invitation to compete, and in doing so, do not endorse the policies of any government.
True, the 49 delegations weren't all welcome like the one from America. But there was really no reason to fret. Look how the non-white athletes were welcomed to the Olympic Village by these good little Aryans. Fraternity and exoticism go hand in hand. One white, one black, of course. All in time to a fanfare that also sets the tempo for disciplined youth, meant to fill the roles of guide or orderly. after these bright newsreel images, Miss Riefenstahl's murkier ones. Totalitarian regimes always prefer form to content, so they can show what's hidden deep inside without voicing it. Like here in an Olympic village transformed into a kind of new world where athletes reconnect with the essence of an original purity presumed lost. August the 1st, 1936, the big day at last. Goebbels, the first to believe in the games, had reason to rejoice.
Meine jungen Kameraden, die 4,5 Millionen Stadt Berlin hat sich in Grün und Flaggen geschmückt. In diesem Sinne grüßen wir Jungen die Flamme, die da kommt mit dem Spruch: Heilige Flamme, glüh und verlösche nie.
For the games, Goebbels asked that the most visible signs of repression and anti-Semitism be removed to put a more appealing spin on Germany. It fell upon smiling hostesses and the press service to demonstrate impeccable German organization for foreign journalists. Meanwhile, cameras and announcers were set to bear witness, or else survey. Never before had an Olympic celebration been turned into such a staged spectacle. Even the Hindenburg joined the fun. The festivities looked all the more impressive from above. Never had a sporting event been so exploited. The only thing missing now was the supreme mastermind, Adolf Hitler, of course. At 1 p.m. that famous August the 1st, he turned up to rake in the glory. With 91,000 spectators to welcome him, he had reason to gloat. Flanked by Henri de Baillet-Latour, president of the Olympic Committee, and Karl Ritter von Halt, president of the Organization Committee, each filled with solemnity, the Führer played it simple. A nice lesson in opportunism by a puny leader who just 3 years earlier wouldn't even hear of the games, which he called an invention of Jews and Freemasons. Could he have dreamed up a better reception? A more beautiful tolling of the bell? There's no denying Hitler had gained confidence. Unlike 6 months ago in Garmisch, the cameras were right up close to get a better view as he raised the curtain.
Ich verkünde die Spiele von Berlin. Zur Feier der 11. Olympiade neuer Zeitrechnung als eröffnet.
Thousands of Heil Hitlers combined with as many doves of peace. How could anyone make a better show before a new smokescreen? The smoke from the Olympic flame, carried in by Fritz Schilgen, a modest 1,500-meter runner whose medal-perfect profile is worth every performance. Already the stadium was cheering for German sprinter Erich Borschmeier. No spring chicken, he had already captured a silver medal for Germany 4 years ago in the 100 meters. In the first semi-final, the public has eyes only for him.
Fertig.
In the fourth lane, he labours more than flies over the track, but nevertheless manages to qualify without much trouble. The public and Hitler have reason to delight. Down on the lawn, Leni Riefenstahl doesn't want to be left out. 90 minutes later comes the final in an electric atmosphere. Borschmeier is there, of course, not far from Jesse Owens, one of the 19 black athletes in the American delegation. With a streak of world records already to his name, he's the favorite. Borschmeier has reason to worry, flanked by two other Americans, black athlete Metcalf and the little Yankee Wyckoff. Even the Führer is squirming. Don't think of anything. Just run as though the track were on fire, Owen's coach tells him. Borschmeier is already lagging behind. Up ahead, Owens is loose and fluid. First gold for the African-American athlete, and a great moment for sport. The public was spellbound, ulterior motives forgotten, as they cheered the fastest man alive. Another paradox. The grandson of slaves had never received such an ovation back home, where he wasn't even allowed into certain clubs. The next morning, after the qualifying rounds for the 200 meters, he also had to compete to qualify for the long jump. His main opponent, another German, the young Lutz Long. His style was rather mechanical, but he had all the ideal Aryan qualities. With his first jump, Lutz easily passed the 7 meter 15 qualifying distance. The jubilant Germans couldn't have asked for a better opening play. Strained and tense, Owens hadn't yet recovered from his earlier race. He struggles to find his footing and misses his second chance to qualify. In the interim, the two rivals talk. About what? Only they know. Even if many like to think, the friendly Long advised Owens to adjust his approach for a better takeoff. At any rate, for his last qualifying jump, as American fans looked on anxiously, Owens landed just a half centimeter beyond the fateful qualifying distance and was immediately congratulated by his chivalrous opponent, a moment Riefenstahl's cameras wouldn't linger on. But never mind, a legend was born, a friendship of black and white, in this Germany of hate. That afternoon, the sun-drenched stadium filled once more for the final. Another legend was in attendance, Max Schmeling, an old hat at manly showdowns. From the start, Owens seemed to have forgotten his failures of that morning. Seven meters 74, off to a good start. Hitler and his cronies are perched in their lookout. Germany needs to strike hard. Long is more focused than ever. More importantly, he's fast enough to land far from the takeoff board. 7 meters 74, tied with Owens. Owens turned for his second jump. Leaning so far forward, he nearly loses his balance. He takes off as his countrymen watch on. To jump 7 meters 87, 13 centimeters better than long, and it's America's turn to go wild. Hitler and von Schirmer look rightly worried. The Olympic arena finally boasts its duel. The German versus the American, white versus black, civilized versus savage. Long's in a tight spot. He has never crossed the 7 meter 80 mark. And it's 7 meters 87 for him too. Even the Führer leaps out of his seat. Once more, Long is tied with his rival. Better yet, as the stadium goes nuts, Germany takes the lead thanks to Long's better averages. But Owens hasn't had his last word yet. Before an array of cameras and the watchful eye of his opponent. His run-up, now fine-tuned down to the millimeter, launches him through the air. To break the 8 meter barrier. 8 meter six, a new Olympic record. And up against that, there's nothing more the good Lutz can do. Owens, the black athlete, has scaled Olympus. Two gold medals in 48 hours, and two others to come in the 200-meter and 4x100-meter relay. Single-handedly, he changed the course of the Berlin Games without even realizing what was truly at stake.
I'm very proud to have won. Wonderful competition here, wonderful stadium, and a wonderful crowd. And the days have been very nice. And the people here in Germany have been very nice to me. And I'm very glad to display my talent here. Thank you.
Leni Riefenstahl was nonplussed. Her film was meant to celebrate German infallibility, but sport isn't so easily taken in. And it's the US that dominated athletics, the key category of the games. Well, if you're going to talk about America, you may as well combine business with pleasure. Or so it seemed for the insatiable Riefenstahl, involved in a steamy affair with handsome American Glenn Morris. A champ in decathlon, an event combining 10 disciplines, Morris would reenact how he won the gold for his mistress and for posterity. Lenny could then blend fictional scenes with footage from the real competition. With her lover, every shot lingers. Better yet, her concern for aesthetics and disregard for true sporting stakes had her completely reenacting Glenn Morris's 1500-meter final under the lights. In her famous film, Olympia, over 7 minutes are devoted to her handsome lover, compared to less than three to Owens, the real hero of the games. Even though the friendly handshake between Glenn and his German rival at the end of the fake final was another pretext to get a befitting message across. More aestheticism in the equestrian eventing competition, though the treatment is more realistic when foreign competitors take a tumble, like French lieutenant Margot. Spills that made the German riders look even better, like Rudolf Lippert. Or better yet, Captain Ludwig Stubendorf, who galloped straight for the goal. Each an SS officer, brilliant horsemen of the Reich, who, along with their teammates, weightlifters, shooters, and gymnasts, would capture 33 gold medals for Germany in the more soldierly sports. And when victory wasn't to be had, like here in Eights, the key rowing event, Riefenstahl would simply ignore the race and focus on the spectacle, the better to fascinate her viewers with. Epiphany of her overblown ode, Diving, where Riefenstahl pulled out all the stops. Dives filmed in reverse, and men who soar back up into the sky or else dive in tandem, whereas no event of that sort was ever on the docket. By the closing ceremony on August 16, Riefenstahl and those she served had managed to draw the 1936 Olympic Games into their own world. A world where symbolism supplanted reality, where flags bowed down, where the laurels of peace still seemed convincing, while 1 week later, Hitler would increase his army from 600,000 to 800,000 men, a size equivalent to what it was on the eve of World War I. Whereas for now, to conclude the 11th Olympic Games, anti-aircraft searchlights were once again sweeping the German sky. The vainglorious Hindenburg had floated over the games before setting its own records in the fall. Crossing the North Atlantic at the astonishing average speed of 97 miles per hour, the longest journey linked Germany to Brazil non-stop. A few months later, Ernst Udet himself would spice up the show when he attempted to attach his tiny aphid onto the belly of the whale to deliver a few extra bags of mail. Though the aerobat managed to hook on, he didn't push his luck. In May 1937, the Hindenburg set off once more for New York, another journey for a handful of the privileged few. After 62 hours of flight, on May the 6th, 1937, the giant Skyliner and its passengers approached Lakehurst, its American docking point. Under cloudy skies and mediocre light, the landing dragged on a bit before the usual crowd of curious onlookers. Captain Lehman was at his post when suddenly there was a jolt. The back burst into flames. 32 seconds of hell. Half minute was all it took for the 88,000 liters of hydrogen inside the fragile blimp to burn and send one of the greatest jewels of the Nazi regime up in smoke. Death toll, 35. And adding insult to injury with the usual flock of journalists gathered for the Zeppelin's arrival, the disaster took place before the eyes of the world. Less than a year after the Olympics of Berlin, the Hindenburg was the first of Hitler's champions who would, one after another, race straight to their demise. That being said, the spectacle surrounding the repatriation of the bodies was impressive. A little more, and the coffins could be seen as trophies, and the funeral ceremony a glorious vigil. Miles east, in the Himalayan foothills, other conquerors of the Reich were pursuing their quest to ascend, once and for all, Nanga Parbat, the German mountain. The Germans had made progress since their last expedition. Their best climbers underwent advanced physical testing and for the first time benefited from backup breathing apparatus. Methods were less sophisticated when it came to the porters. They were goaded forward with a stick. For this 1937 expedition, beginning a few days after the Hindenburg disaster, some 20 Sherpas already employed by the British were specially recruited. They were the experts who would advise and caution. On May 22nd, the ascension began in earnest, leaving from base camp number one. But already they were slowed by the altitude. By the time they reached camp number two, 4 days later, the weather had turned bad, exhausting the men and blocking them. In such appalling conditions, it would take nearly 3 weeks for the advance party to reach camp number five, located 5,000 feet from the summit. Before another avalanche swept away everything in its path. Search efforts made by the survivors put the number of casualties at 16. 7 Germans and 9 porters, the most terrible mountain disaster to date. Meager relics for conquerors who'd planned to plant the first flag on top of the Himalayas to symbolize Germany's domination over the world. Once again, Nanga Parbat proved elusive, brushing aside the Reich's men to put them back in their rightful place on Earth. At the same time, over on the other side of the world, others were traveling under more clement skies. Elie Beinhorn and Bernd Rosemeyer, still crazy in love, weren't too concerned with their role as ambassadors of charm. But in a totalitarian regime where everything has meaning, seduction and merriment can't be left to chance. On July the 5th near New York, the dishy race car driver who'd come to capture the Vanderbilt Cup was also there to export a dash of German excellence. On a deadly racetrack, long forbidden as being unsafe, before a captivated audience of American gentry, the Yankees discovered the daredevil skids of a driver always on the limits of adhesion. Ellie was watching, of course, like a Greek goddess enjoying the exploits of her husband, Eros. After Mercedes dropped out, the Auto Union Archangel sped to the lead on the wild track. To be declared once more the winner, this time on American soil. To him went the laurels and the cup, bestowed by the wealthy, elegant Mrs. Vanderbilt. A lady at his feet, and a higher SS rank back home, he had his work cut out for him in a world where Germany and America had not yet drawn their swords. Who ever said Nazis weren't ordinary people? Just look at SS Obsturmführer Rosemeyer. All gaga for little Bert Jr., whom he and Ellie coddle like the eighth wonder of the world. But in racing, as in war, after showing America the great, what he's made of, now it's jolly old England's turn. Especially since its driver, Malcolm Campbell, came up with the incredible Blue Bird, a combination car rocket. The very British Malcolm had become the fastest man alive in 1935 on a beach in Florida. That day, to the glory of His Majesty, Campbell broke his former record by 19 miles per hour, reaching the phenomenal speed of 301 miles per hour, a record that still stood. But the Reich's champions, starting with Rosemeyer, refused to be left in the dust. The Führer's race cars, particularly Ferdinand Porsche's, had to be the fastest. In October 37, Rosemeyer took the wheel of the new Auto Union Streamliner prototype. The Führer demanded German records be broken on German autobahns, never mind that they were lined with trees and their surfaces less smooth than a beach of packed sand. Rosemeyer was the first to break 248 miles per hour on a highway. 252, to be exact. 2 months later, on January 28, 1938, the anniversary of Hitler's rise to power, Rosemeyer was duty-bound to set a new world record. It was close to noon when Archangel Bert boarded his Auto Union, outfitted with new side skirts to reinforce traction, while the usual henchman installed the string he would break at top speed to record his new performance. Strange, though, this empty shed that looks like a mausoleum. Further down the road, at 267 miles per hour, Rosemeyer's Streamliner went airborne in a gust of wind and crashed into the ground. The Archangel was killed on the spot, leaving nothing but a jumble of metal. After the Hindenburg and Nanga Parbat victims, it was now 29-year-old Bernd Rosemeyer, the Reich's most glorious race driver, that it lay to rest. How special this German excellence is, consuming the Führer's conquerors one after the other. It's unsure Elli Beinhorn, overwhelmed by grief, truly understood this on that day. From here on, the real ace was him, presenting himself triumphantly in the Berlin Arena for the 1938 May Day festivities. The sole runner on the track, him, beneath an Olympic flame that had been put out for good. instead of athletes, in a stadium entirely devoted to the great Germany. This time, there could be no doubt, the smokescreen of the 36 Olympics had entirely dissipated. But there was one champion left, Max Schmeling. Boxing is the only sport Hitler mentions in his manifesto Mein Kampf because it promotes the spirit of attack, demands lightning decisions, and trains the body in steel dexterity. For 2 years, Joe Louis had been plotting his revenge. In one corner, a German barbarian that the great Joe, symbolizing democracy, must send limping home. Over in the other corner, Hitler's slugger, giving the pickaninny a sound walloping on the backside. Long gone were the days when Schmeling was the darling of the American press. Germany was growing more and more disreputable. The Nazis dreamed of a match in Berlin, but they had to compromise with the other gangsters, the godfathers of the boxing business, equally adept at staging a spectacle, as shown by this electric weigh-in. The fight was broadcast throughout the US and over in Germany, of course, where the champion's wife and Goebbels were glued to the radio. June 22nd, New York. Joe Louis was well prepared. Immediately on top of his game, Louis decided to make short work of the lead-footed Schmeling. With his guard up, after the experience of their first match, the Brown Bomber didn't give his terrified opponent any chance to take the lead. Before diligently massacring him. Barely 2 minutes into the match, and Schmeling was already down on the mat. And then a second right hook knocked him out for good. In less than one round, Hitler's ambassador had been pulverized. But there was still the cinema with its power of illusion. In 1938, Leni Riefenstahl had finally made it through the 440,000 yards of rushes for her film Olympia, shot during the Berlin Games. Though the film, backed by authorities, was applauded in Germany, not everyone was so easily taken in by the ode to the human body and triumphant Aryanism that had little to do with sport or the reality of a world where the Reich's champions were often trounced. The US boycotted the film and refused the opportunistic filmmaker the chance to see it in American theaters, more interested in finding out if the man-eating Riefenstahl was also Hitler's mistress. Another occasion for cynical Linney to simper and giggle.
The newspapers say that you are Mr. Hitler's best lady friend. Is there any truth in that?
Oh, that is only a newspaper story. It is not true.
Just a newspaper yarn.
Only a newspaper story.
How long have you known Mr. Hitler?
Oh, I know him since the year 32. 1 year before he would be in Reich Chancellor.
On July the 3rd, 1939, Hitler inspected the testing ground at the Rechlin airfield alongside Marshal Göring, head of the Luftwaffe, and Ernst Udet at his right. Though Riefenstahl wouldn't own up to anything, her ex-lover Udet, who now wore the boots of Director General of Aviation, was fully involved. Unlike his superior Göring, who campaigned for heavier bombers, ex-aerobat Udet was more interested in daring and lightness, properties of the fighter aircraft he hoped to develop. But without further ado, 2 months later, Hitler took the plunge. September the 1st, 1939, he invaded Poland. Just 2 weeks later, he flew over Warsaw, flattened by the bombs. World War II had begun. In 1941, Marshal Göring summoned his military staff to study the next move on the Eastern Front. His old crony, Ernst Udet, was there too, looking rather lost among the others. Despite his ostensible zeal, Udet believed Germany was ill-prepared. He was skeptical about the outcome of the war, especially since Hitler had attacked Russia. Annoyed, Göring held the disgraced defeatist at a greater and greater distance. His crackpot eyes now turned to younger, more resolute figures, such as new ace Werner Mölders, 28 years old and already 72 victories to his name. Udet was relegated to holding the door in the background. On November 17, 1941, in a state of depression, the ex-World War I flying ace Ernst Udet shot himself in the head. The authorities passed it off as an accident. The appropriately sad-looking head honcho was present to confirm this, along with Göring. Udet's longtime friend turned close enemy, shedding crocodile tears for the occasion.
Jetzt müssen wir Abschied nehmen. Unfassbar ist uns der Gedanke, dass du, mein lieber Udet, nicht mehr unter uns weinst.
Like a marathon leading nowhere, his national funeral was organized with great pomp. With Udet, yet another conqueror had failed. Another model finished the race earlier than planned. Our other champions, for lack of attaining glory in the stadiums, would be sent to another starting line, that of the war. The time had come for them to pay. Starting with Max Schmeling, who in 1941, at the ripe age of 36, was reduced to playing Tarzan in a paratrooper unit. That's what you get for losing to a Negro before getting shoved into thin air for a propaganda film. Schmeling may look awkward in the air and crash to the ground like an old sack of potatoes, but at least good old Max would pull through, whereas countless others would never manage to cross the finish line. Like Lutz Long, Jesse Owens' chivalrous rival, struck down in the prime of life at the age of 30 on a beach in Sicily. The four ski jumpers from Garmisch, birdmen with unknown faces, all dead on the ground. Like Ludwig Stubendorf, the star horseman of the Berlin Games, killed not far from the legendary Berezina River. True to herself, pretty Leni Riefenstahl, who served Hitler and the Nazis throughout the war, would continue to work and take advantage of her position before denying all responsibility and guilt after Germany's defeat. Of our conquerors presumed to embody Aryan superiority, through their performance and one upmanship. What was left in the midst of war? A widow and her child, perhaps. Elie Beinhorn and Bernd Jr., driving a much less powerful vehicle than his father, Archangel Rosemeyer. In 1945, Berlin would fall beneath the bombs, but the Sportpalast, although ghostly, simply couldn't be forsaken. Before widows, orphans, and cripples, achievements and records were no longer appropriate. But once again, sport had anticipated history in its own way. The Führer dreamed of watching all those champions shine on Olympus. They were actually nothing but heralds of the approaching disaster, which we hope has taken its final bow here.